Have you ever found yourself, in the quiet moments, whilst scrolling through monotonous feeds of putrescence on your computerized telephone, contemplating the very essence of intelligence? Specifically, the kind that exists not in our own minds, but in the minds of the machines that we've created. Perchance. Okay. Look, even though AI is used to peddle nearly everywhere in 2024, machine learning and artificial intelligence, they are here to stay. And there is one piece of hardware helping to propel this AI boom forward that's still pretty new to us as consumers, neural processing units, or NPUs. Buckle up, because we are going to break down what exactly an NPU is, how they work, what they're going to enable in the tech that we use every day, and most importantly, why you should even care. Spoiler alert, NPUs are certain to be a big deal, even though they aren't really all that different than the chips that we've been using for decades. I'm sitting in front of a Commodore 64. This low-cost home computer was and is iconic. It's often cited as the best-selling computer model of all time, with an estimated 30 million units moved. Now, inside this beige beauty lies a MOS Technology 6510 microprocessor. Like modern CPUs, this chip fetches, decodes, and executes instructions to process data, but it relies on a supporting cast of nearby chips to make all that magic happen. The VIC-2 graphics chip handles video output, the SID chip produces its legendary sound, and there's also a boot ROM, input-output controllers, and a whole mess of supporting circuitry like hex inverters, serial controllers, interface adapters, and more. Add in the 64K of RAM, hence its name, the clock crystal and other components like multiplexers and logic gates, and this is quite the intricate dance of technology. Now, the C64 didn't have a built-in operating system like modern computers do. Instead, it boots directly into BASIC, a programming environment that's stored in ROM. If you wanted to load a program, you'd either have to write it yourself or connect to an external device, like a floppy drive, cassette drive, or cartridge. Insert that, turn on the system, and, well, we're off to the races. Yeah, okay, in 2024, there's nothing much to look at. This is pretty rudimentary. But frankly, even in its heyday, this microchip was just too weak to manage very much on its own. It had just 3,500 transistors, and that's compared to the literal tens of billions that we have in today's processors. And this limitation meant that even in 1982, it needed coprocessors to handle specific tasks, like floating point calculations, audio synthesis, and video output. On the Commodore 64, that was typically done through these external expansion slots. But this was a budget machine. If you went and got a nicer computer with a Zilog Z80, those were populated out the wazoo with chips everywhere, all performing different functions. But over time, more and more of these chips and more of these functions became consolidated onto CPUs that were just really good at doing lots of things. And eventually, GPUs emerged to handle graphics and parallel tasks. And for a while, that was kind of all we needed, in addition to a motherboard chipset. But as we began to reach the limits of Moore's Law in the 2010s, CPUs and GPUs alone, they just weren't enough anymore, which sparked the rise of specialized application-specific chips once more. The key difference now is that these are not coprocessors spread across a circuit board the size of a dinner table. Instead, they are located on the same tiny die as the CPU, forming what's known as a system-on-chip, or SOC, a term that you're likely familiar with because you've got one right now, probably in your hand. Smartphone SoCs have multi-core CPUs and GPUs, yes, but there's also an entire ensemble of specialized processors all working together in harmony. I mean, you've got a controller for managing memory, you've got a modem for handling 5G and Wi-Fi 7 connections, an image signal processor will perfect your photos, video encode and decode engines handle particular file codecs, security processors store your biometrics for authentication, power management units handle energy distribution, and a whole host of other chips exist, all packaged into one tiny, mighty piece of silicon. Okay, but why orchestrate all of these different pieces as opposed to just throwing a general purpose chip like a CPU at every task? Well, there's a bunch of reasons, but in my eyes, it really boils down to three main ones. Number one, users are just frankly more demanding of results than they ever have been before. For example, SoC video engines tap into enormous amounts of memory bandwidth for real-time, high-resolution 8K and 4K encoding and decoding, rather than requiring us to just wait around. Number two, as devices, like phones and laptops, become more demanding in terms of their performance, specialized hardware can just better perform given tasks much more efficiently while using significantly less battery life than general purpose compute ever could. And number three, tasks handled today are simply way more complex and diverse than they ever used to be. And many aren't really served all that well by a CPU, like machine learning and AI, hence the need for an NPU, or neural processing unit. While a CPU is built for general purpose tasks, shuffling data around, executing instructions one after another, an NPU is designed specifically to handle parallel, repetitive number crunching that powers machine learning models and other AI accelerated workloads. The heart of an NPU's capability lies in its ability to perform massive amounts of matrix multiplication and vector operations all at once, which is essential for neural networks and for on-device LLMs. By processing thousands of small calculations simultaneously, NPUs excel at the math-heavy workloads that are needed to run AI, all while using less power and getting results faster than a traditional CPU could ever really hope to achieve. And today's sponsor, Qualcomm, and their X-Series SOCs for Windows laptops pack a seriously meaty NPU. An NPU capable of 45 trillion operations per second, or TOPS. This thing is faster than almost any other NPU on the market, which makes it perfect as a testbed to show you what NPUs can practically do for you. Accessibility has always been a little bit underserved on desktop operating systems because, frankly, using image recognition and neural language processing, stuff that helps people that can't use traditional input methods, it's just always been too taxing on regular CPUs and GPUs. You'd need a crazy powerful computer for kind of mediocre results. Neural processing units really excel in this regard, however, and I'm going to demo it to you. This is an application called Cephable, and if I come in here and say start camera, you will notice that a little camera preview opens in the top right corner. It detects my face, and not only will it show and reflect head movement, but even facial expressions, if I smile, if I blink, and more. And you can use this to navigate through a traditional operating system. I've not set up very many settings. It goes way through the wazoo, which you would want to do if you were going to use this as your primary navigation method. But I'm going to show you just a couple features. If I come over to Chrome, I can tilt my head right, and it navigates through a tab. If I tilt my head down, which I already did, there we go, it opens up my download history. And if I smile, it opens up a new window. This is just a small preview of how absolutely insanely powerful navigating through an operating system can be if you're using an NPU. And you will see that the NPU was fairly heavily taxed because this is a fairly demanding workload, but it did it and using just a few watts of power. All right, I'm gonna give you another demo here. This is one that might be more conceivable or believable or usable for the vast majority of people. I'm gonna go to live captions. This is built into Microsoft Windows, and I can find any video in another language, press play, and you will see that it starts to show those captions translated to English real time. This is a video in French. If I move to a video in Spanish and press play, it continues real time, and you will see, and this is what I think is so cool, look at that NPU. It was barely using single-digit performance out of our NPU, which is one of the most efficient parts of the Snapdragon X Elite SoC. Way more efficient than using a CPU or a GPU. And doing either of those processes on the CPU and GPU would consume vastly more power. It's more efficient and more performant, and that is super cool. NPUs don't just enable new workloads, they also improve workloads that are fairly poorly handled by a CPU or GPU. One such example is here in DaVinci Resolve, a color grading suite and nonlinear editor that most YouTubers, or at least many YouTubers, use to edit their videos. What I'm going to do here is take this little pen tool and select this subject because I have applied a color grade on top of the rest of the background. And it is going to see, as you can see, cut out this woman perfectly. I just draw a line and it automatically separates her from the rest of the background. If I hit this button, it is going to start using the NPU to track her frame by frame throughout the scene. This is something that has always been managed by the GPU, and if you have a really powerful GPU, can do so pretty well, but at extreme power consumption. Not something very viable on a laptop. This is performing perfectly adequately, about 5 frames per second, which might sound really slow, but it's not. It's actually pretty good. And we're sipping just mere watts from the wall because the NPU is only at 50% utilization and our GPU is sitting pretty. That's all there is to it to create a magic mask layer inside a DaVinci Resolve using an NPU. It works really well. I know it's going to sound like I'm beating a dead horse, but I really have to reemphasize the efficiency gains here because they are truly something to behold. I mean, not only was the NPU in this machine able to handle the tasks that I threw at it just as quickly as the CPU could have, but it did so using a tiny fraction of the power, keeping this machine, a laptop, cool as a cucumber and providing me better battery performance, well, than just about any other laptop I've ever used. Now, this isn't an overnight computing revolution, okay? It's specialized hardware, and it's going to need specialized software. It's still early days. Most workloads that would thrive on an NPU don't exist yet. Like, even Microsoft's own Copilot does not run locally. That's forthcoming. And applications like LMStudio, a similar LLM that you can load into your local environment. So if I load up Llama 3.2 and say, write me a short story, doesn't peg the NPU at all. 0%. Now, there's a version in beta that utilizes the NPU that should be publicly available near here soon, but right now, it's pegging the CPU basically at full speed. And the performance of this is fairly remarkable at about 80 tokens per second, but that speaks more to the Snapdragon X Elite's impressive SOC and CPU rather than the NPU itself. Look, even when you do have NPU support, not everything functions consistently. But as more devices move towards application-specific hardware, operating systems and programs will become better equipped to handle them, just as the most impressive Commodore programs came over a decade after the machine's initial launch. Look, by now it should be clear that NPUs are going to be a big deal in the future. And while it's still a bit of a novelty to see an application use an NPU effectively today, in just a few years, it'll be as indispensable and as frequently utilized as a CPU or GPU, enabling a future of even better application-specific hardware and AI. Thank you so much for watching, and as always, stay snazzy.